the session by introducing you.
Okay.
I'm
So
handling.
I should wait.
Yes, sir. Professor Agrawal?
Yes.
Yes.
So it is really my great pleasure to introduce Professor Ashok Jain. Of course, most of us, we know him very well, but still, I mean, for the benefits of those who doesn't know him, he did his PhD from Banaras Hindu University in the year 1977. And then he was there for a year as a research associate. And then he joined in 1979, University of Roorkee, which is now IIT Roorkee, that became in 2001. And he continued there till 2015. And for, before retiring, he was almost head of the department for about last 10 years or 11 years. And he has been really the member of the executive committee in India. Very actively participated in, various activities with INGA. And then, he is basically the backbone for conducting so many SERB schools, even the current cycle which is going on. He is a key person behind that. And one of the very unique, feature of him is that he has collaborated with many of the experimentalists in India. And so he is basically, in that sense, a complete nuclear physicist who did theory as well as experiment. And he has been the visiting fellow of the, many national and international labs. And he has been teaching for last, more than 36 years. He has produced 12 PhD students, and he has supervised, the MSc project, which is of the order of 60. So he is, the most dedicated nuclear physicist in India. And today he'll be talking about various properties associated with the seniorities or the seniority isomers, some interesting results you'd like to share. So with that, I would like to invite Professor Jain to start the talk.
Thank you, Vijay. Thank you so much for a nice introduction. I hope everybody can hear me.
Yes, please.
Okay, I wish to first of all compliment the young organizers of this group who have been carrying out a very nice activity, and every week they are holding a very nice seminar or talk. I also thank them for inviting me to give this colloquium type of talk on the role of seniority, generalized seniority, and some of the results that we have obtained in recent years. I will share the talk with you now. I hope you can see the... Can you see the talk now?
Yes.
Okay. So the title of the talk, as you can see, is The Governing Role of Generalized Seniority in Isomerism and Moments. Now, the outline of the talk is like this. I will summarize the outline. I will not read the outline here. There are mainly three parts of the outline of the talk. First, I will give a brief introduction and some textbook details also to introduce seniority, the history of seniority, what seniority is, how it became so useful in nuclear physics, and then some examples, the characteristics. And then I will go over to an extension of the seniority to what we now call generalized seniority. And in doing so, I will show you some very nice results, very new results that we obtain, and how this gives rise to seniority isomers, and how we were able to solve this puzzle of the twin asymmetric parabola of the BE2 values in the twin isotopes. So this is roughly the outline of the talk. And in the end, I will conclude with some future directions for our work. So seniority was introduced by Raka in 1943 in the atomic context. So he was trying to distinguish between atomic electronic states which had same L, S, and J values, but there were a number of different number of particles were giving rise to these L, S, and J values. So in trying to distinguish these states, Raka assumed a Hamiltonian, which is like a pairing Hamiltonian, a short-range interaction between pairs of electrons. And these electrons were coupled to angular momentum zero. Now, this was a very surprising assumption for two electrons, because we know they are electrons carry a negative charge and they are highly repulsive Coulomb interaction. But by using this Hamiltonian, he obtained a set of eigenstates with a good quantum number, which he called seniority. In 1950s, this picture was adopted in nuclei in exactly same fashion. In fact, the short-range interaction was well suited for nuclei because we know pairing is a very short-range interaction in nuclei, and it fits into this picture very well. So with this historical introduction, I can say that seniority quantum number may be loosely defined as the number of unpaired nucleons that you require to generate any given state. And the algebra that it satisfies is the same as the spin half algebra, the SU2 algebra. An example I will give where seniority works so well is that of even event. This is the longest isotopic chain now known from mass number 100 to mass number 138. So you can see that only few of these thin isotopes are actually stable. Rest of them have been produced in the laboratory and studied in laboratory. So this is a remarkable achievement of experimentalist in nuclear physics, having produced such a long chain of isotopes. The thin isotopes, which have proton number 50, a very robust proton closed shell, only neutrons are the valence particles, and if you look only at the even thin isotopes, then the first excited 2+ state has a nearly constant energy from the ground state, which is 0+, right from 102 10 to 130 10. You can see in this picture over here. So this energy of 2+ states is nearly constant. This is a very interesting observation. You keep adding neutrons, and the energy relative to the ground state does not change. So these states, these 2+ states of the thin isotopes, the first excited 2+ state, is given a seniority V equal to 2, seniority quantum number V equal to 2. Implying that one pair of neutrons have broken the pair. We have one broken pair of neutrons and they are coupling in such a way to give you 2+ state. But not just the 2+ state, even the 4+ and 6+ states are also generated in this manner. Now, some key features of good seniority is that we now know. I can state them here without proving. One that I have already given you is the particle number independent energy of a state having same spin parity and seniority. So that I have already shown you in 10 isotopes. Then we have some specific electromagnetic properties for single J orbitals. A parabolic behavior of the electric quadrupole transition probabilities emerges. and also a particle number independent variation of magnetic moments. It is very actually easy to prove that any interaction between identical fermions in single J shell conserves seniority exactly if the orbital angular momentum is J is less than or equal to 7/2, 7.5. Because in this case, there is no chance of seniority mixing. So all the states, they have pure seniority. Now, this key feature of seniority, or these key features of seniority, they continue to be observed in tin isotopes throughout the whole valence space. And this valence space of the tin isotopes from a neutron number 50 to 82 contains as high as J equal to 11 half orbital also. So we do observe many of these features very nicely, although some seniority mixing will definitely take place here because we have a multi-J environment now, and presence of different seniority states for J greater than 7.5 is possible. So some seniority mixing definitely is possible. So at this point, one makes a transition from pure seniority or single J seniority to multi-J seniority, which we now call generalized seniority. And I will give you an idea about that little later. First, let us look at the single J seniority, because this is a very nice textbook example. And one can work these things out very easily. So seniority in a single J shell is dealt with in a very simple way in what is now called the quasi-spin scheme. This quasi-spin scheme was introduced by Kerman and Helmers in 1961. They define a quasi-spin operator, which is basically a pair creation operator, Sj plus, which is a product of particle creation time reverse states, a pair of particle creations. Similarly, one can define S minus and S naught, which are basically pair annihilation, and basically number operator kind of operator, S naught. S naught is actually equal to N minus omega by 2. N being number operator, and omega equal to, which we call pair degeneracy, this is equal to 2J plus 1 by 2.
Sorry, sir.
Yes.
Sir, noise aa raha hai, background noise is coming.
Noise aa raha hai? Actually, there is a thunderstorm going on here.
Okay.
So, what I can do is, I will change the, maybe, you are seeing my slides?
Yes, I am able to see the slides. I am able to.
And you are able to hear me also?
Yes.
Yeah. So there is a thunderstorm going on outside.
Okay.
Yeah, and it started exactly at 8.
Are you using some earphones or something?
Okay, let me try to use the earphone. Okay, can you hear me now?
Yeah, it is better than before, sir. It is better than before.
Okay, all right.
Okay, thank you, sir.
So, I was talking about single J seniority and the related algebra. So, once we have defined this pair creation annihilation operator and S naught operator, which has a eigenvalue n minus omega upon 2, where n is the number of particles, omega is the pair degeneracy, which is half of 2j plus 1, and j is the orbit angular momentum of the orbit. These operators define a SU2 algebra, and the pairing Hamiltonian, basically a constant pairing Hamiltonian, has a simple solution, And this solution is given here in terms of these quantities S, which is basically quasi spin, the pair degeneracy omega, and N, the number of particles. We can convert this into what we call the same relation. Same solution can be written down in terms of the seniority quantum number V also. So it becomes half N minus V to omega plus 2 minus N minus. So the V, the quasi spin S, and the seniority both can be used actually, but it is seniority which has become very useful and popular now. So it has a loose in physical interpretation that it represents the number of unpaired nucleons in the given state. Now, if we look at a level structure of a nucleus, which is nearly spherical or close to magic number, then it has a typical level scheme as shown here, 0 plus, 2 plus, 4 plus, 6 plus, 8 plus. You can see the levels are coming closer and closer as you go up and down. This is kind of inverted rotational structure, I call it. And you can see the seniority quantum number is also written here, 0, 2, 2, 2, 2. That means 2 to 8 plus states generated out of J equal to 9 half, they are all having seniority. So we have particles being filled up in J equal to 9 half, and this particle number filling is plotted here on this axis, x-axis. And the transition probability, the electric transition probability, multipole transition probability, is plotted for seniority conserving and seniority changing transitions. For seniority conserving transition, for example, from 8 plus to 6 plus, you get a minimum, a parabolic behavior with a minimum in the middle of the shell. On the other end, for a seniority changing transition, you get an inverted parabola. So the transition probability is maximum in the middle. So you can see that for the seniority conserving transitions, it is possible to have isomers in the middle of the shell, because here the transition probability is very small. Not only that, the energy difference between 8 and 6 that you can see, this is the top level, it is very small. So it is generally the highest spin that you can generate. And we call, as you will see, these are the most aligned states. They give rise to isomers near the middle of the shell when the shells are being filled up. And no odd multipole electric transitions are possible in single J shell because parity change is not allowed. But as we will see in generalized seniority, this relaxation is obtained. So as you go to the multi-J shell situation, which is the actual situation in a real nucleus, because any given shell has several orbits and different J values and even different parity. So these orbits are best, this situation is best dealt with by using or generalizing the quasi-spin scheme that we have just discussed briefly. The concept of generalized seniority, or the name generalized seniority itself, was first introduced by Arima and Ishimura in 1966. And they gave a detailed mathematical formulation of generalized seniority. However, the formulation that we are going to use here is quasi-spin scheme. Again, we generalize the quasi-spin scheme and define a pair creation operator S plus, which is now a summation over various S plus operator for different J orbits and multiplied by a constant alpha J, a phase factor alpha J, and summation over alpha J S plus. So this is now our pair creation operator. It takes care of all the J orbits now. Alpha J is equal to plus minus one. Similarly, one can define S minus S naught, and the generalized seniority that we have defined like this, it satisfies the symplectic algebra of symplectic groups. And here we define the pair degeneracy as half of summation over 2j plus 1, because earlier this summation was not there. Otherwise, all the results, relations are nearly same. So in this formulation, The phase spectrum alpha j is actually minus 1 raised power L, as used by Irview and Moskowski in 1966. But here we use, and you can see L, depending on L is even or odd, it will be plus or minus 1. Now, a very interesting paper was recently written by Kota, who pointed out that the phase choice alpha j is arbitrary, and in general it leads to two raised power r minus one quasi spin SU2 algebras with r number of j shells and alpha j equal to plus minus one. So if there are r number of j or number of orbits is r, then this is actually a typo here. It will be 2 raised power r minus 1. So that many quasi-spin SU2 algebras can be generated. And each of these SU2 algebra represents a pairing algebra. So as a result, we obtain multiple pairing algebra, although there are no experimental evidences so far for the additional pairing algebras. And we continue with our discussion with the usual pairing algebra that we generally are used to. But this is a very interesting observation of Kota. And I think it would be interesting to explore these additional algebras because they can be very useful in understanding the quantum phase transitions and order to chaos transitions in nuclei. So the extension of seniority seniority selection rules to generalize seniority is a very important result that we obtain. That means when you go to generalize seniority, the selection rules change. So in single J shell, what the seniority says? Seniority says that for odd multiple transitions, the operator behaves as quasi-spin scalar. For even multiple transition, it behaves as quasi-spin vector, whether it is seniority changing or seniority conserving transition, for both. And electromagnetic decay selection rules, they have their own conditions. For odd multipole, only magnetic transitions are possible in single J shell, and for even multipole, only electric transitions are possible. Now, when you go to multi J shell, what the generalized seniority says, you can notice the change here. Now we have both odd and even multipole transitions possible in magnetic as well as in electric. However, in magnetic case, these operators still behave as quasi-spin scalar, and therefore only seniority conserving transitions are possible. Whereas in electric transitions, the operator behaves as quasi-spin vector, and therefore we have both seniority conserving and seniority changing transitions possible. So now it is possible to have a transition in which parity also changes in the electric transitions. That means we can have transitions, electric transitions E1, E3, etc. possible. Because so far only electric quadrupole transitions were considered the most dominant decay mode in seniority states. I show this in a pictorial way because you can see that for the generalized seniority situation, the bottom figure here gives you the transition probability, and you can see that the parabolic behavior is now true for even multipole as well as odd multipoles, whereas inverted parabola is true for seniority changing transition, and this is true for seniority conserving transition. Whereas in the magnetic multipole case, you will always have a constant particle number independent behavior, whether it is even L or odd L. So summarizing the new selection rules, which are so crucial to our further discussion, we have electric multipole with L even, which is a quasi-spin vector. An electric multipole with L odd is also a quasi-spin vector. However, we need at least two orbits in the shell of different parity for the decay to occur. And this was very rigorously proven by Cota recently. And this is something that we showed earlier, and then he has given it a very nice mathematical structure. And the magnetic multipole with L odd is quasi-spin scalar, and magnetic multipole with L even is also a quasi-spin scalar. And for quasi-spin scalar, because it is scalar, so it only transitions which conserve seniority they are allowed. For quasi-spin vector, we have both seniority conserving transition as well as seniority changing by 2 units. The transitions both are allowed. Now I give you some evidence, the first evidence of this new kind of seniority, odd multiple electric multiple transitions, where seniority is conserved. Here you can see this solid line. Seniority is conserved, so you have a parabola with a minimum in the middle. And now here you see for E1 transitions, this is the data for the tin isotopes and odd tensor seniority conserving transitions are observed here. And our calculations, which are shown here by red, assuming tin 114 as the core, where we have frozen the G7 half and D5 half orbit in this 50 to 82 valence space. And we take the remaining 3 active orbits, H11 half, D3 half, and S. These 3 orbits together can give 3 possibilities of 3 pair degeneracies, omega 7, omega 8, omega 9. The calculations are able to reproduce the observed behavior for omega 9 only, because the transition probability is proportional to omega minus n upon omega minus v whole square, and this proportionality gives rise to this behavior here. And this, in a way, also suggests that the states here, these seniority states, they have H11 half, D3 half, and S half admixture in their functions. Similarly, we are able to show the odd, the similar result for E3 transition. Now, E3 transitions are seniority changing transitions. So here we have an inverted parabolic behavior. And active set of orbitals here in the calculations are G7 half, D half, D3 half, S half, H11 half. If you assume the core at n equal to 58, that is G7 half is full, then the calculations give us for omega equal to 9, the red dotted line, and for omega equal to 11, the blue dotted line. So you can see that the red dotted line comes closer to the observed behavior for the BE3 values. These are the E3 transitions. And this is supported by a large scale cell model calculations that we did, which by using the same valence space as in the case of seniority is able to give you a nice reproduction of the observed behavior of the BE3 values, as shown here by the blue line, which comes closer actually, and where we have to shift S half by 9.9944 MeV. In fact, this point here, the last point 124, right, or tin 124, is actually exactly coming on the measured experimental value, and is shown here by this arrow. Because here we could do the cell model calculation in the full space. In other cases, we could not do calculation in the full space. So there is some deviation that we see. Now, we come to the role of configuration mixing E2 seniority isomers, which is the most common type of seniority isomer. You can see that there are 2 sets of examples here, 15 minus isomers which decay to 13 minus, so by E2 transition, and then we have 10 plus isomer which decay to 8 plus states, by E2 transition. In both the cases, the experimental data shown here by black dots, they are reproduced very nicely by the seniority, generalized seniority calculations, and for the 15 minus isomers as well as for the 10 plus isomers. Only deviation is for 130 TIM. As you can see, the theoretical, the generalized seniority calculations begin to deviate when you reach the end of the at the far end of the 10 isotopes, 1028 and 130. And this suggests that there is something happening here. Probably some seniority mixing has started here. Otherwise, by using omega equal to 9 PR degeneracy in this case, and omega equal to 9 PR degeneracy here in this case, we are able to explain the behavior of the seniority isomers, E2 transitions that the seniority isomers are undergoing. We have shown the same results by half-life calculation. We have converted these BE2 values into the half-lives, measured half-life, because it is the half-life that is measured experimentally. And you can see that this reproduces the measured half-life for 10 plus isomer, for 15 minus isomer, and for 13 minus isomers reasonably well. Now we come to another situation, another very interesting problem in nuclear structure physics. This corresponds to the first excited 2 plus state that I have shown you in the very beginning, in the tin isotopes, which decays to the 0 plus ground state by E2 transition. And this is a seniority changing transition, delta B equal to 2. And therefore, we expect that the BE2 values will show a parabolic variation with a peak in the middle as predicted by the seniority scheme. In fact, our relativistic QRPA calculations by Ansari and Ring also confirmed this by their calculations. However, recent experimental observations, they support a dip in the middle of the valence space, and therefore they give you two asymmetric parabolas. I will show you this figure actually first, then we will come back to it here. So you can see that the experimental data are plotted by these squares, and you can see there is a dip in the middle, and then again there is a parabolic. So there's kind of two parabolas instead of one big parabola that was expected from the seniority, pure seniority approach. Now, this observation was attempted by many theoretical approaches. Many theoretical groups have tried to interpret this anomalous dip in terms of overexcitations or polarization or reduced collectivity, etc. But they could not explain this. On the other hand, the work by Morales and Pete Panisekar, they were able to explain the minimum in terms of different rates of filling of the orbits. How the orbits are being filled, the rate of filling is different. Now, since there was a lot of confusion about the data, there were many measurements for a single nucleus, and not only that, there were a lot of variations in the values, uncertainties were very large. So we decided to do a re-evaluation of the whole two values for all the 10 isotopes. And this evaluation was done, and we plotted the evaluated values here. What I am showing here, these are the evaluated values of the BE2 values. And by using the generalized seniority calculations, where we now, what we did was, we divide the whole valence space from G7 half, D5 half, S11 half, D3 half, and this is a S half into 2 before the middle of the shell. This whole shell, big shell, we consider G7 half, D5 half, D3 half, S half. And after the middle of the shell, we consider G7 half as frozen and we include D5R, D3R, SF and H11. So before the middle of the shell, it is this G7R, which is the highest angular momentum particle and dominates. After the middle of the shell, it is the H11R which dominates. And therefore, 1000 is the natural choice for the core, and omega is equal to 10 for these orbits. And after the middle of the shell, 118 is the natural choice because 8 particles have been filled. G7.5 is full. So omega, the pair degeneracy becomes 12 for these states. And the calculated values can now be plotted here, as shown here. And you can see that for omega equal to 10, the red dotted line, and omega equal to 12, the red dotted line, but with open circles is shown here. And they are able to reproduce this twin parabola very nicely. Now, this result was further confirmed by us by using large scale shell model calculations before and after the middle of the shell by using the same balance set of valence space and which corresponds to omega equal to 10 and omega equal to 12. And you can see that the blue lines, they reproduce the whole pattern very nicely. And this actually resolves this long-standing puzzle of the twin parabola in the V2 values of the twin isotopic chains. We have also verified or check that other configuration or other combination of orbitals, they do not work actually. Now this takes us to another interesting problem which we tackled, and this was for the extremely neutron-rich tin isotope beyond the doubly magic 132 tin. Now we have experimental data on 132, 134, 136, and 138 tin. And there is a 6 plus seniority isomer observed in these three isotopes. The experimental data are not complete, but whatever experimental data are there, they are shown here in the three cases, 134 tin, 136 tin, and 138. Now we did a shell model calculation here by using a renormalized CD bond potential, and we found that in order to reproduce these B2 values as well as the level structure, level energies properly, it was necessary to not only modify the diagonal and non-diagonal two-body matrix elements by a small amount, 25 keV, for the neutron F7.5 orbital. On modifying the interaction, the B2 increases and the seniority mixing also increases slightly, but the calculations with the unmodified potential, which is shown here by red line, cursor is disappearing over here. So the red line, which is here, is the original interaction, and the modified interaction gives us this result by the blue line, which comes very close to the experimental data. So our observation at that time was that a slight seniority mixing is occurring, and this is giving rise to this change in the value, and bringing this data closer to the observed data. However, we decided to visit this result when we started doing generalized seniority calculations. So we revisited this result of neutron-rich isomers by using generalized seniority. And we found that if we use the generalized seniority by including all the orbitals in the neutron number 82 to 126 valence space, except for I-13 orbital, which we left, then this gives us a pair degeneracy omega equal to 15, and the observed data are reproduced very nicely by the generalized seniority calculations. or the B2 values for the decay of the 6 plus isomer to the 4 plus state. So the generalized seniority appeared to resolve this anomaly in a very nice way, because if you do not use the generalized seniority, then this middle value at 136 should have a 0 BE2 value. So the result should go like this actually. But now it is going very smoothly. So using this, taking this as a cue, we decided to do a shell model calculation again. So in the new shell model calculations that we did, first of all, we used a new set of single particle energies taken from the recent papers. Not only that, the location of I-13 of orbital was modified as per generalized seniority, because we excluded I-13 of orbital in our generalized seniority calculation. So we moved it away from rest of the orbitals, giving it a gap at 112. So this is the I-13 half orbital, which is lying a little further away from rest of the orbitals. And the two-body matrix elements was also reduced by 25 keV. And when we do that, we find that we are able to reproduce the data for all the three isotopes, not only the level structure, level energies, but also the transition probabilities very nicely. So this in a way confirms the suggestion that came from the generalized seniority calculations, that I-13 half orbital probably lies further away. And this shell model calculation confirms that it had to be taken further apart in order to reproduce the results. So the BE2 trends of 6 plus isomers, therefore, strongly suggests that the location of I-13 half orbitals needs to be adjusted in a significant way to get the best fit of both the level energies and the transition probabilities. And this may result in a possible subshell gap at neutron number 112. Now this brings us to, we are nearing the end of the talk now, and I will briefly describe some of our recent results, where we have calculated the magnetic moments and the G factors. The generalized seniority dictates that the magnetic moments should also exhibit a particle number independent behavior in multi-J environment. We know that the magnetic moment is defined in this manner, mu equal to GJ. Now for a multi-J configuration, what we do is, instead of taking J, we take a summation over J, and this is basically our J tilde as it appears in the generalized seniority situation. It's coming from the combination of several J orbits. So when we do that, then this formula actually can be used to calculate the G factor from the generalized seniority Schmidt model. We know the Schmidt model very well from the textbooks. So what we do is we replace J everywhere in the Schmidt model by J tilde. And the pair degeneracy omega is defined as summation over half summation over 2 J tilde plus 1. So by using this, we can calculate the G factor using different omega values. So if you do that, then the G factor calculations for the 2 plus states in the tin isotopes, they come like this. The black squares are the experimental data, as you can see, from 112 to 128. And they divide neatly into two groups. One group is lying below zero, G factor zero line is this, and the other group is lying above the zero. So these are positive G factors and these are negative G factors. What we observe is that if you take the generalized seniority Schmidt model, where we include all these orbits G7 half, D5 half, D3 half, S half, and omega is equal to 10, then we get this red line, constant particle number independent behavior. On the other hand, after particle number 116, 118, we get the other red line, which is here, and this is having a negative G factor now. So the trend of the G factors is nicely reproduced by the generalized seniority Schmidt model. On the other hand, if we take the pure seniority Schmidt model, then the values would be lying here, shown by the blue lines, here and here. So they come closer to the experimental data, and the experimental G factor values have large uncertainties. So probably as the uncertainties lessen, new measurements, probably we will be able to say more about it. I come to the G factor for the high spin states in tin isotopes, where we have calculated the G factor for the 11 half minus states and 10 plus isomers. You can see that the here the experimental data are sufficiently large in numbers, and you can see that the generalized seniority model calculation is able to reproduce this constant G factor for all these 11 half minus states very nicely, which are showing a constant behavior. This is the blue line is the Schmidt model value. Similarly, in the case of 10 plus isomer, here only three values are known experimentally, and the calculated generalized seniority Schmidt model values, they are in line with this observed values, measured values. Similar results we have obtained recently for quadrupole moments, and this work is still in progress. So I will just give you one slide here. This is unpublished work, and here we show the quadrupole moments taken from Nick Stone's table. And as you can see, Yartsenov recently highlighted the linear behavior of the quadrupole moments for the 11 by 2 minus states of neutron rich cadmium isotopes. And this unique simple behavior of complex cadmium configuration was quite surprising, actually. So behavior of isotopes having two proton G7 half particles and two proton G9 half holes in comparison to the closed shell in isotopes by the generalized seniority scheme is shown here. As you can see, this is for cadmium isotopes, and this is for tin isotopes, and this is for tellurium isotopes. So cadmium isotopes have two proton holes in G9 half, and tellurium isotopes have two proton particles in G7 half orbital. And these red lines are the calculations by using the generalized seniority approach here. And you can see that they are able to reproduce the observed trend very nicely in all the three cases. So, just a moment. Okay, so I will just now summarize these things here. What we have seen now is a new kind of generalized seniority isomer which decay by event transitions. We presented new selection rules for generalized seniority states, new set of selection rules. We also presented the first explanation for the B through trends in view of seniority changing transitions. We have been able to resolve the longest standing puzzle of the BE2 trends for the first excited 2 plus states in the 10 isotopes. Confirmation by the large scale cell model calculations has been done in most of the cases by using the same valence space as suggested by the generalized seniority. The G factor trends in various semi-magic nuclei has been understood, and quadrupole moments in and around semi-magic nuclei, they also support the generalized seniority interpretation. Some future directions I can just put here. The isospin quantum number plays an important role when we want to include both type of nucleons. So far, we have in our calculations considered only one type of nucleons, valence nucleons, neutron or proton. But now, if you want to bring in, consider situations where both type of particles are playing a role, then we will have to bring in an isospin quantum. And therefore, the SU2 Lie algebra will be modified to symplectic Lie algebra, symplectic SP4 group algebra, and this may lead to some new results. This will also answer the question, how far can we stretch the seniority scheme as we move away from the semi-magic nuclei and consider both type of particles. Also, the linkage between different classes of isomers can be foreseen in that case, how the seniority isomers, they as the nucleus starts getting deformed, how they merge or how the other type of isomers arise from this. So these are some future possibilities that we can think maybe undertaken or maybe seen in future. Thank you for your kind attention. I think I have not taken.
Thanks for wonderful talk.
Okay, Bharat. So now,
now for lesson for discussion.
Yes. Yes, any questions or any comments or something is not clear somewhere, I can make it clear then.
So, sir, I have a question. So,
yeah.
Small question. So, have you tested for lead nuclei, this seniority?
Lead?
Yeah,
we have some results for the lead isotopes. We have not shown them here.
Okay.
We do have. We are considering nuclei near other magic numbers also. So, we do have some, yeah. But we have focused on 10 isotopes and around 10.
Mostly Professor Garg also focus on this 10.
Mm-hmm.
So what is the deep physics behind this?
See, the seniority concept of seniority of this quantum number, seniority quantum number emerges from the pairing interaction.
Right.
And the symmetry groups that we use, these are the special units, SU2 groups, or their kind of counterparts are used. So asymmetry that is involved here is related to the pairing, basically. This is one thing is sure. In the ground state, the even nucleus is completely paired. Right. And it's like a superfluid state, or you can say a Bose-Einstein condensate kind of thing. And when it is doubly magic, it is certainly is like that. So as you break a pair, example, I create a 2+ state. Now, is it also a, some kind of Bose-Einstein condensate? It looks like that it is probably the same class of a state. Mm-hmm. And that in the pure J, in single J orbit case, this pure seniority situation, this is directly visible. But when you have multi-J seniority, it is not directly visible because there is a mixing of states here involved. But the system tries to adjust itself in such a way that it becomes a good paired state as far as possible, because that gives us the lowest and a lower energy. So my feeling is that this all seniority business is related to this symmetry, which gives rise to this kind of highly coherent states, highly coherent states.
Okay. So sometimes people talk about softness of the thin nuclei, all this. What is that? This
softness?
Yeah. Thin is floppy, all these things, this word.
See, this softness, what do you mean by softness actually? A softness basically simply means that the structure of the nucleus can be changed rather easily. It is changing its structure or its shape or other properties as you go from one state to another state. That means the states are the nucleus is when you, it is transiting from one state to another state, if you go, why the property will change so much? Or say, for example, the shape changes as you go from one state to another state. So why it will happen? Basically because there's a lot of mixing of the wave functions. Mm-hmm. And the transitional nuclei generally show this kind of behavior, where this is expected also.
Yeah.
Because nucleus is making a transition from a spherical robust shape to a deformed robust shape, and in between it is actually undergoing changes.
So I think someone has written some question. I will read it. So Dr. Bunia has asked some question.
Yes.
Concerning the filling of the level along with pairing and without pairing effect, what is the quantity value in percentage?
Quantitative value in percentage. I am not getting fully the question, but I think he is talking about the filling of the various orbits.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. And with pairing and without pairing.
With pairing and without pairing. Yeah. Well, so I have not shown such results here actually. We do have results where we show the occupancy of different orbits. And this can be obtained and with pairing and without pairing also. We have these kind of results with us, but I don't have those slides here right now. to show you. And changes do occur in the occupancies of the orbits. Sometimes the changes can be very significant also. So unfortunately, I don't have those slides here, because they will clarify this question, how the orbits are filling. But there is a significant change in many situations where you have different seniority states. So when you say pairing or not unpaired particle, that means seniority is different. So for paired, you have seniority 0, say, and then there are unpaired state, they have different seniorities, say 2 or 4. So the occupancies change in a significant way, yes.
So, sir, another thing. So, in India, anyone is performing this type of experiment, senior isomers, all these things?
Yes, there are groups who are doing isomer experiments on isomers. One group is there at IUAC. They have been doing this in a couple of experiments they have done in the past also. In fact, they have done experiments on tin isotopes itself. And then in TIFR also, Palit has done experiments on isomers.
So have you used this data in your paper?
Yes, yes.
So this, in this Pramana paper, I think you have used, right? This, you have shown this two parabolic plot. One of, in your paper, I think I have seen one of its slides.
Nuclear physics paper.
Nuclear physics, okay.
Hello, okay. Sir. There is one more question. Bharat, you can ask. Hello.
I think.
Hello.
I think, sir. Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, maybe I can try to answer the question. I think he is not able to listen.
Okay. Hello. Okay.
He's asking.
Question. Yeah, okay, go ahead.
Yeah, he's asking, mostly we get shape isomer in super heavy nuclei. Is it possible to study within your model? No, not right now. I can remark on that, because seniority is conserved in nearly spherical nuclei or spherical nuclei only. So, what is a shape isomer? Shape isomer, I do understand that when the decay involves a shape in change. So, we cannot handle the deformation right now for studying seniority scheme.
One question I want to ask. Hello.
Yes, I can hear.
Sir has just shown the slide in 6 plus state. He has not included I-13 half. Am I right?
Yes.
Yeah. What is the reason behind it?
Actually, we have used generalized seniority scheme. Okay. Mm-hmm. Then we found that if we use omega equals to 15 corresponding to the configuration, which does not include I-13 half, is able to reproduce the experimental data for those particular isomers. So from there, we got the suggestion that we can try to perform shell model calculations without having this orbital in this particular valence space. And we did that, and interestingly, the results were coming closer to the experimental data.
Okay. Thank you.
Am I clear?
Yeah.
Bhumika, what is the limitation of your model? You can only probe up to Z equal to 82 nuclei, or is it probe up to higher super heavy nuclei also?
Super heavy nuclei are, I don't think so, they are spherical in nature.
For example, most of them. Z equal to 120, people are thinking this is a spherical nuclei.
Yeah, we don't have any access to there yet, so I have not tried. I haven't tried yet.
Okay. I think.
Yes, but if it is spherical in nature, then seniority will be conserved. But right now I haven't tried, so I cannot remark on that.
Okay. I think there will be some
I have one more question. Usually isomers are detected in heavier nuclei, heavier than tin. Is there a chance in future, some random probability that maybe we can find them in medium mass nuclei as well?
Actually, isomers are known from lower mass to medium mass to heavy mass. So it is already known.
No, I am talking specifically about the seniority isomers.
Seniority isomers are already well known in lower mass and medium mass region. Basically, if you say, if I go lower than tin region, then seniority isomers are actually well known. This was the whole point actually. They used to be studied by pure seniority scheme because there the chances of seniority mixing was not available. As the quasi-spin algebra tells us that for J less than 7.5, okay? Mm-hmm. Most of the isomers are due to intruder orbitals, if you know, in a particular valence space. So for J less than 7.5, quasi-spin algebra tells us that the seniority is a conserved quantum number. So we don't have to worry about seniority mixing so much. Okay, so the isomers were explained using pure seniority scheme there already in 1960s and beyond.
Okay.
So this was the main conclusion from our work that the extension from the pure seniority scheme to the generalized seniority scheme has been told, and the recent measurements of the high spin isomers and particularly the even decaying isomers, which were not known in a single J scheme. As you know that in a single J scheme, there is no chances of parity mixing. So electric dipole isomers are cannot exist there. Okay, we cannot explain. Okay, so people were speculating only about E2 seniority isomers back then. So this was interesting. Sorry, sir, I took over.
I didn't know that I'm logged out. Anyway, I have joined in. So I don't know if Mrityunjay listened to my answer about shape isomers.
Yes.
He had a question on shape isomers in super heavy elements.
Yes, now you can answer, sir. We are able to listen to you now.
Yeah. For shape isomers is not applicable. Directly, isomers are possible there. Because it is a quantum number near the measurements.
Yes.
And,
the angular momentum will not be a good quantum.
Balance. So it is important. We will have a kind of okay.
Sir, I have some question. So without experimental data, suggest using your model, can you suggest the experimental people? Yeah, this is my model and I have predict something. Can you perform some experiment for like heavy nuclei or something like that?
Yeah,
you have done some studies?
Done some experiments.
No,
I think he's asking about super heavies, that in super heavies can we predict something like this?
No. Well, super heavies, we have never thought about it, whether we can predict it there, because what is the magic number of super heavy elements? This is itself a point of contention. Even now, what is the magic number? So if we know the magic numbers, and then we can probably make some predictions, yes. Yeah.
I think N equal to 100 people are N equal to 100 people are saying this is a magic number of these things. So I don't know whether it is correct or not, because I think Professor Prahara sir has predicted something. N equal to 100 and Z equal to, I forgot. they are saying this is a magic nuclei.
Yeah, I mean, you can, because this is a, so many models, so many theories, so they are all predicting. Correct. There is no, that is the whole
And I think, sir, he is talking about deformed magic number or something like that.
Deformed magic number.
Yes, oh, and equals to 100 and all are deformed magic numbers. So,
they are not spherical, yes. Okay.
I want to point out here that from our model we can actually predict many unknown things near the nuclear extremes. Okay, like in neutron-rich nuclei, in proton-rich nuclei, where now we can access at, from our present experimental techniques, we can predict many things there.
So I think in your model, as far as I know, and also Prasad sir model, I know his model is not working without knowing experimental data.
We need some energy.
He used single particle energy and reproduced the experimental data. That I know hardly for calculation. I don't know in your case, you just use the input as a experimental data or?
Yes, we take one, at least one value we need. One value we need, and then we predict, calculate the rest of them. We are calculating the matrix elements. No?
Similarly,
and that is the reason it is working so well. But once we have enough data, we can actually obtain, extract the matrix elements also. So that reverse thing can also be done, which we have not done so far. Because we have data, then using the model, we extract the matrix elements.
Like the shell model.
Matrix elements, how much order? Like 20 by 20 or some, which order?
Matrix.
Matrix
changes according to the active orbitals, active set of orbitals. The number of, as the number of the orbitals increases, the matrix increases accordingly.
Okay.
It is just, it just depends on simple angular momentum algebra, you can say.
Okay. Actually, I don't know much about all these things, just I ask. Are there any questions?
Gagan, I think I have replied your question completely. Or not? Then let me know.
Okay. I have a question. I'm going to, as you were saying that in the extreme nuclei, it's possible to predict something. So is it possible to predict the meltdown of magic numbers in extreme nuclei? Breakdown of magic numbers?
Yes. We may hint toward that because I have been, so we have not actually taken care of any such thing right now, but we may hint towards that when the magicity breaks.
Yes, okay.
It will tell you the competition between basically the spherical magic gaps, whichever we say 2A, 28, 50, 82, 126. Okay. If they will not work, then the seniority scheme will also not work as per our knowledge right now. So by using this thing, we can tell that the magicity can be picked.
Yeah, exactly. That is what I was thinking, that from B to value, you can predict that.
Yes, 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 true.
I think we will... Are there any other questions? If not, let us thank Professor Jain, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for nice talk.
Thank you all for listening to me.
It was a nice talk.
Wonderful talk.
It was really nice to see you.
Thank you so much.
Welcome, sir.